It's ironically, for it being very cold, it's a very warm festival. And it's actually the third time I have a film playing here. It's only the first time that I've come. This kind of intimacy, you don't find in any other festival. And I've been to enough. So I cherish that. Firstly, it took a while to get made. Because a film that's trying to make a comment, not just politically, but socially. And hold up some sort of a mirror to who we are and where we've come. Is hard to find backers for. So Manoj and I were trying for almost 4 years to find producers for it. We did a whole lot else in the meantime, but when it finally did happen, it's been an intense journey, even the making of the film. I don't know what to say about it other than how it was to make, because it's a story. It's also a film that doesn't really depend on a story, so it's very hard for me to summarize the film, really talk about it. Every film is visual, and there's something that I took away from Kubrick. Kubrick was the first filmmaker who used to assert that as a filmmaker, your primary responsibility is to create imagery that has not been created before, if you want to call yourself an artist as a filmmaker. And I took that very seriously. So even if it's an emotional story of one old man, I spent a lot of time with my crew trying to figure ways to see this man through the lens that may not have been explored before in the medium. Mm-hmm. Find a new idiom that only works for the film. So when you do that, and the first draft of the film had a lot many more dialogues than the final film does. But when you try and find that visual idiom that will communicate a lot of what you're trying to say, you start realizing that you have to rely less and less on dialogue, which is not really a very cinematic tool. Dialogue is more theater, writing. And although, yes, we spend most of our lives talking like we are doing, but the medium itself has so much that you can explore in the visual and the audio that it was. The biggest epiphany for me on this film was how little I need to rely on dialogue if I can take the effort to find an audio-visual paradigm that is unique to the film. So we started stripping it away. Through the rewrites and through the workshops and through the discussions, I kept knocking dialogues out. On shoot, there were days when he'd come rehearse with a few lines and I'd say, "Sir, those two lines, drop them." So it was a constant chipping away at the dialogue till we ended up with 21 or 22 lines of dialogue in the entire film that Bhonsle speaks. Dialogue is, I find it a crutch in a lot of films that contradicting Richard Linklater by saying that, because Before Sunrise, Before Sunset, dialogue heavy films, but they are structured around two people talking. But if you don't have that at the core of your film and you're trying to explore themes and motifs and philosophies, dialogue then becomes a crutch. And a lot of the parallel cinema films, the Indian parallel cinema films of the early 80s, very well intentioned, some very, very good writing and performances in those films. But there's a reason why that movement died a quick death. There was a lot of didactic dialogue. When someone wanted to posit their philosophy, they'd stand there and speak for 6, 7, 8, 12, 15 minutes sometimes. And that's very uncinematic. So I kept telling myself that if I have to put these ideas forward, I'll try and do them through cinematic tools and not through dialogue. At the heart of the idea of those films is two people conversing. So you can't grudge those films their dialogue. But there are a lot of films that, and I'll speak for Indian films here, because European films have gone past too much talking and found newer ways of cinematic exploration. But most Indian films, when there's complex ideas to be communicated, the filmmakers don't have the patience and the stamina. They have the talent, but it takes time and effort to find newer ways of saying the same things and not relying on the actor always to, you know, mouth everything for you. I think it'll be fairly evident that it was a very, very deep and engaged director-actor partnership. And this is something that we did on our short film Thunder as well. So I get misunderstood when I say what I'm about to say now. I see actors quite like the light and the choice of lens and the choice of production design. I see them as a tool in that frame. The only difference is that they're the most prominent tool. And the best actors are the ones who can offer themselves to the director as the most precise tool that the director might need for the film or the scene or the frame that the director is trying to create. And Manoj does that. Even on Tandav, he just surrendered himself. And I communicate a lot. So he and I have long conversations about the character, what the character's motivations are, what exactly is happening at that point. There are times when, like in Tandav, for example, so even in Bhonsle, he's mostly static because we spend a lot of our lives also very static. Like you're sitting, I'm sitting. We're not actively moving. And there's things happening around him that the character may not need to know. But, like we're sitting and talking, and until this moment when I was about to make this point, it didn't strike me that there are kids making a noise outside. But somewhere that has an... Even if very subtle, it has an impact on how we are engaging here, because it made you shut the door to keep the noise out. Instantly, it has affected this interaction. So I keep feeding him all this information and he just keeps assimilating it. So this is something that we tried on Tandav and then it worked on Bhonsle as well. We conversed for 4 years. So even if there's something happening next door to him in Bhonsle's house, I kept feeding Manoj all that information. And you know, both of us sort of figured out what this guy would do. Because also with the camera, I'm very specific in the way I see my protagonist. The way I see Bhonsle is very different from the way I'd see the other characters. So that frame needs to be inhabited by that actor in a certain way. So we workshop a lot. And in the workshops, I give a lot of freedom. Like, this is what I want to do. How do you think you want to interact with this camera, with this space, with that bed, with this prop? And we arrive at a certain consensus so that on shoot, I don't allow freedom because we don't have the resources to keep, experimenting on set. So it's a team effort. It's not like I do my job, you do yours, and then let's see what happens. And Manoj's trust in me, and on Tandav and Bhonsle, I got almost blind trust from him, is very, very empowering. Whatever wings I found to fly with were because he trusted me. And he keeps people off my back. If someone questions the film, what I'm trying to do, he says, look, I trust him. I know what he's doing. So back off. Give him a chance. And I don't know most actors who do that for their directors. This conflict, for lack of a better word, of the insider and the outsider, today is playing out in every country. From America to Syria to India. Only in India, it's a lot more convoluted because with every other country, there is the indigenous people of that country and then there is the people who migrated there, whether they were refugees or fifth, sixth, seventh generation, whatever it was. In India, you have like 28 or 30 official languages. You have that many states which culturally operate as independent nations. Now, within this country, when you're told that you're from Bihar, you can't come to Maharashtra and work, it's a problem. Because constitutionally, I'm allowed that. But because we are indigenously two different people, you're going to have issues with me coming and working on your turf, using up your resources. As much as I understand it being unfair on the Bihari, I also understand it being unfair on the Maharashtrian, because this is your land. And you anyways don't have enough for yourself. And when someone who wasn't born here comes and works here and sends the money back to their families where they came from, it's problematic. So this whole idea of the insider and the outsider is very, very complex and murky. And I don't have solutions. I don't know what my stance is, but I want to throw up these questions. Because when you start having this argument about who is the insider here and who is the outsider? I always ask, how far back are you going to trace this to understand that this was your land? For example, I worked actively for many years with the tribals in India, the Adivasi, and to get them fair compensation for the land when companies wanted to come mine their land. Now, when the Adivasi says that this land belonged to me for 5,000 years, you can't just take it for the greater common good, because there is a country called India for the last 70 years, and apparently now we are citizens of that country, but we don't even have voters' ID cards. But we were here 4,930 years before this country was made. So, yes, my heart goes out to the Adivasi. But then the question I have for the Adivasi is that before you came here, there were monkeys. Now, who ensured that the monkeys got their rightful due when you took over the monkeys' land? So, how far back do you go? And where do you stop? And where do you draw that line? And 40 years later, will this line shift 200 feet this way? And what repercussions will that have? So, these are complex questions and no one's asking them. Forget finding answers. So, I just wanted to throw these questions up through the story. No. I never was a film buff.
Okay.
I still don't watch too many films. But what brought me to filmmaking is also a cliche. I was a musician. I still am an artist. I'm a graphic artist. I used to write poetry. I used to write. And I used to do. I was a photographer. And I wanted a medium where I could not have to give up on one to follow the other. And somehow filmmaking just allows you all of that. And that's the only reason I chose filmmaking. Because I get to do a little bit of everything. I just really hope and pray that they don't stop. Because I know the challenges they face, not just infrastructural, but political. And I just hope they never stop. I hope they find a way to keep this going. Because it's a place that has some sanctity. Because most other festivals, except for Dharamshala, all today are screening films in multiplexes, whether it's Cannes or Busan or Mami. And that energy, that energy of exchange of ideas that festivals used to have is being lost in multiplexes. And to see a place that, a festival that has that, is very, very special.